You know, if I actually swapped careers, you know, it was really by default. I was a banker, and I wasn't a lawyer, and I wasn't an accountant. So by default, I fell into real estate. And I'll tell you, the last 10, 12, almost 15 years, I guess now, things have been quite good. Anyway, what I'm going to do today is I'm actually going to tell you a little bit about the, as Will said, the real estate industry is where I'll really focus on. But by default, there is quite a bit of correlation between the real estate and the construction industry. Here's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk on the... Is this mic on? I'm going to kind of move around a little bit. Yeah, we're good? Anyway, I'm going to talk about the current state of the real estate industry, recent trends that we've seen in the last couple of years, key issues of concerns, impediments to growth, and potential opportunities. Now, some of the things that I'm going to talk about, you've already heard addressed by the minister and by President Biles. Just before we go a little further, you know, I know everybody hears Sariba. What is Sariba? What do? Cayman Islands Real Estate Brokers Association, Sariba, is a non-for-profit association that was set up in 1987 to provide a professional network for the different real estate companies in the Cayman Islands. Today, it provides the Multiple Listing System, or the MLS, and acts as a central source of information for its members. Sariba performs a self-regulatory role for its members. All MLS real estate transactions carried out by its members are subject to Sariba rules and the scrutiny of the association's board of directors. The association aims to ensure fair, straightforward, and trouble-free property transactions for anyone doing business with any Sariba members. To be a member of Sariba, agents and brokers must follow the association's code of business standards as set out in the Sariba's rules and regulations. A high level of confidence is expected from all members, and it must adhere to the code of ethics set down by the association. Sariba monitors the business standards and practices of all its members to ensure fair, honest, and professional dealings in the real estate transactions. There are 34 broker companies, 192 real estate professionals, and I'm happy to say $500 million in annual sales. Now, I kind of wanted to point out who Sariba is, because most of the information that I'm going to present today came from the Sariba database. So although we don't represent all of the real estate transactions in the Cayman Islands, the vast majority of them are at some point touched by a Sariba broker or agent. Real estate contribution to the Cayman GDP, you heard and saw Minister Roy present this. The one thing that I wanted to point out here, even though he touched on the top two, I think it's important to note that real estate activities represent 8.5% of the GDP in the Cayman Islands. Number three, only to the two that Minister Roy talked about, financial and insurance services, and then professional, scientific, and technical activities. Current state, where we are right now, it is a seller's market. And you often hear that term, seller's market. It is different than a buyer's market. A seller's market, in effect, is the seller dictating or being more in control of the of what they do with their property, the price point, whether they're willing to sell at a certain point in time. The seller's market is what we're sitting in today. Buoyant market plus limited supply equals increased prices, and that's what we've seen at least in the last couple of years and into 2018. I thought I'd show you this just by giving you a bit of an indication of the number of active listings that are currently up on Sariba. And if you look at 2017, there were 1,600 active listings representing, and this is year to date, so year over year. 2017 representing $1.5 billion in listing revenues, and 2018. You'll see that even though the number of listings has decreased by 7%, the value of those listings has gone up by 25%. So again, as I say, buoyant market plus limited supply equals increased prices. That's a good thing if you're selling real estate, not necessarily a good thing if you're buying real estate. Okay, again, just a bit more information. Property sold, if you look at year over year, and again, this is year over year comparison and almost year to date as of yesterday. 2016, 2017 versus 2017, 2018, home sales are fairly static. Condo sales, if you look at 2016, 17, 342 to 312, you say, well, it's down. And the reason is not so much because there's no demand, it's because there's limited inventory. So that's the effect you're seeing there. If you look over here, volume of total sales is up about 14%. Average house prices, when you look over here, if you take, when we look at average housing, we're looking at both residential and condos compared. And the average house prices alone are up 35% from 727,000 to 928,000. And the average condo prices are up 33% from 575,000 to 758,000. Year over year residential units, even though the units sold are down 6%, the volume sold is up 26%. So again, limited inventory, driving prices up. And the average sold price is up 34%. So again, seller's market. This phenomenon is not the same in all sectors and all areas, but one particular area that is really going gangbusters is the Seven Mile Beach area, and it's definitely leading the way. Again, just more information to share with you. If you look at this, total properties sold, this is in 2017, there were 701 at $463 million. The average per property sold was $660,000. But if you look at Seven Mile Beach, there was 111 sold at $150 million. The average sold for Seven Mile Beach property was $1.34 million. If you look at now, 2018 units sold to date. What's real interesting here is the average per Seven Mile Beach unit sold $1.89 million. So that's an increase of 41%. Where the rest of the sectors are only up 7%. Current ML listings, total current listings right now, as of today, 1,500 listings representing $1.8 billion in listing revenues or listing opportunities. Seven Mile Beach current listings is 202 representing $439 million. So the average Seven Mile Beach listing is 2.1 million, which is up from the 1.89 of last year. So again, we have a limited supply of, when I say affordable, it's a relative term, but affordable Seven Mile Beach property, and hence the prices are going up. The only thing left, if you haven't gone into the Seven Mile Beach game yet, you're almost late. There's virtually no land left on Seven Mile Beach that's available for redevelopment. The last couple of parcels were recently acquired. DART, as you probably have heard, recently acquired the Royal Palm site. And together, when you add that to the other sites they own adjacent, they've got almost 15 acres of beachfront land. And I believe a new hotel is scheduled for development there. The other site that was recently sold was the old Johnson & Johnson site, which is between the Avalon and Harbor Heights. We hear some good things are coming on that particular site. So the other thing I can tell you is the stuff that's been available on Seven Mile Beach, for example, the lower, the type condos, for example, the Harbor Heights of the world, they are being acquired now by two different demographics, one being a person that's saying, look, I just want to get into the Seven Mile Beach activity and buying and holding and hopefully the redevelopment. And others saying, I just don't want to miss the opportunity of being on Seven Mile Beach and having some real estate there. Active market, that's another way of saying it's a seller's market. However, it does depend on a location. Seven Mile Beach and surrounding areas, again, very, very, very strong. The improved local market, especially areas close to Georgetown. If you've kind of taken a drive anywhere now from even West Bay, where you used to have the shores that were vacant land for a long, long, long time. If you take a drive into the shores now, you'll see that there's very left available inventory because people, the access through bypass now is getting people to West Bay in a lot quicker fashion. And so the inventory is being depleted. Outer Islands not enjoying the same buoyancy as the Grand Cayman. Eastern districts, what we're seeing in the Eastern districts, we're seeing people moving out that way. The commercial development is going that way, especially the oceanfront developments near the beaches. And then in this particular active market cycle, this is for significant development, commercial development continuing to move east. Several major projects recently started and scheduled to start shortly. And it's not just DART that that is actually going out that way. Construction is booming. Anybody that takes a drive, you're gonna see what's going on. Again, as I say, if you start from the West Bay and start making your way through Governor's Harbor, we're seeing some renewed confidence in that particular market. We've not seen a lot of activity in the Governor's Harbor market in years, and now if you take a drive through Governor's Harbor, any available land is being developed, especially down if you take almost across from where the Kimpton site is. There's lots going on in there. If you look at anywhere, and again, I keep repeating this, but if you take a drive from down, you're going to see all these new developments that are either on the drawing board or well underway. I think we've counted there's about 40 of them that are either work in progress or slated to be developed. In the old days, if you would drive through a development site, you'd see a sign that would go up and say pre-construction, pre-sales, and before you ought to go there, what ended up happening, the sign was down and they would turn into cow pastures, so there was nothing that would happen. Today, when you see the signs go up, it's just a matter of time before the actual sales have been executed, even long before the projects even have a shovel in the ground. Here's some of the new projects. This is one that's slated for Seven Mile Beach. This one is a Rum Point Club. And the first one I showed you here for Seven Mile Beach, Agua, that one there, went under market, or went under, went up for offer, and already 80% sold. This is the new Hyatt Regency, Grand Cayman, I've been on medication and I'm still floating here. This is the new Hyatt that was recently announced and they've started to sell. If anybody wants to buy Seven Mile Beach property, this is where I would say you can have a good opportunity of getting it under $1 million. Right now, anything that's on the market, you're hard-pressed to find anything under $1 million. You can get into these particular developments at about $500,000-$600,000. You buy a one-bedroom unit, and they'll put it back in the rental pool. This is another one, a Brian Butler development that, again, recently came to market and sold out already, and they haven't even put a shovel in the ground. And the price point here is just under $2 million, and as I say, as soon as it hit the market, it went under all of the units, and there's under contract. This one is Finn, and what we're also seeing is a movement from Seven Mile Beach Corridor, where all of this type of development used to be, it became a bit unaffordable, and so there was a developer that said, hey, let me try the other side of Georgetown, and put up the first development. I think you may have seen it. It's a complex called Kisha. It took a while to get rolling, and now 100% sold out, followed by the old Seaview site. I think everybody remembers that. That was redeveloped into upmarket condos, followed by Oceana,